I was very appreciative of the word that Brother Ducille brought early on in the meeting. I believe it was the second meeting that he ministered, that we had, on the basis of the thought of God's intent from the very beginning. Some may think that I am stuck in a rut, but it's a rut that is eternal. And it seems to have no end of the thought or the intent that God has for us as a people in this time frame. You know, many of us have said we live in a very opportune time, and I don't know that we really understand the ramifications of that, or even the ability or the position that we stand with regards to God's time frame and the desire that he had way back in the beginning. Hallelujah. And I can't get away from the thought. 2 years ago, God began to move upon me and began to give me some sort of comprehension. As little as it was, it excited me. It stirred me up. And I've been speaking about it ever since. Hallelujah. And that is the thought, the intent of what God has for us as his people, as his children. Hallelujah. I don't know why it is that God desired to make man as he made him, other than to demonstrate the fact of the reality of his ability to be God in spite of everything. The fact that God could get all into this man's life and get a hold of him is something beyond my imagination or my thought process to understand how that could hardly be possible. Hallelujah. And yet in God, God was able to touch my heart, stir me up, and to put his hand upon my life. And I look at people, individuals around me who are either in as bad a shape as I was or worse shape than I have been. And God stirring in their circumstances miraculously beyond our comprehension, beyond our ability even to believe. How many times have you gone into a situation that you really didn't believe God would do something, and in spite of your unbelief, God did something? I think everyone should have that experience. In fact, that's the way that it seems that my life is. He's always showing my inability to believe, and in the midst of my unbelief, it seems that God does something so miraculously and so astounding and so absolutely supernatural that I have to know that it's God. Huh? Hallelujah. If anybody wants proof of a living reality of God, all they have to do is look at me. I am the proof of a living reality of God. I was bound for hell. I had hell inside of me, hell all around me, hell coming out of every pore, every aspect of my being. Hell was present and working to conform itself to the position, the place that was prescribed for me by virtue of the blood that I was born in. And in that position, in that place, in that condition, God moved in a miraculous way. Hallelujah. I'm so thankful that he had a plan for me. I'm so thankful that he has a plan for you. Hallelujah. I'm so thankful that that plan incorporates and includes the totality and the immensity and the magnitude of what we call God that we do not comprehend or understand. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. There was something that God wanted in the very beginning. It's amazing to me. I suppose he did what he did as far as establishing the Word of God, the Bible, and had so many people living and dying and going through so much trouble and tribulation, just so that in that time frame of his, that as we came on the scene, maybe just me that came on the scene, that he has given me the ability to begin to perceive and understand the concept that he had in his mind from the very beginning. Man has taken that concept and he's twisted it, he's perverted it, he's done all sorts of things with it to try to fulfill what he believed or thought was the will of God. And in doing of all of those things, nothing that was that what God wanted was ever done. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Because it's stated very simply, very easily, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26.
God had counsel with himself. Huh? I don't know what it must have been, but it must have been something. Huh? And I don't know how the magnitude and the immensity of that building. I don't even know if heaven might have been standing around in breathless anticipation, wondering what it was that God was conjuring up or concocting in his eternal laboratory. But I can almost imagine the anticipation in heaven as the council of God came together and they begin to consider and begin to plan for the advent of what the scripture calls man. Hallelujah. But God did not intend man just to be man. Do you know that God had no thought that man should just be man, that he might be human and remain in that position and in that place? It is inconsistent with the word of God that was spoken back there in Genesis chapter 1. Inconsistent, and yet we have done everything we can to conform religion to give us the excuse to remain in our position of humanity. Hallelujah. Because we think that human is something that is divine. Oh, yes, we do. We make excuses for it. We get Bible verses out and begin to quote them and spew them out as though they were platitudes to give us the confidence that our humanity is something that God made and therefore something that we have to abide with and be comfortable with. But the fact of the matter, in plain English and in the simplicity of the scripture, that is not what God said in the very beginning. When the council of God gathered together and they begin to come into a position or a place of agreement to move in the things that pertain to this realm that was earth, he said unto himself, he said, let us make man. How was he supposed to make man? Human and frail? How was it with his inadequacies and his positions, his place of weaknesses and of flesh and the blood in which that flow would flow through his brain? No, that wasn't the intent. That wasn't the thought. That wasn't the idea. God said, let us make man. How? In our image. Let us make God not only in our image. He said, let us make man in our likeness. So the intent of God was not that we remain in a human position of weakness, not remain in a human position or a place of less than substandard in the eyes of God. God intended for you and I to move out of the realm of the secular, out of the realm of the natural, out of the realm of the carnal, into a realm that he calls heaven. Amen. But you know, heaven in the church theology has become a place. I want to tell you something. Heaven is not a place. Heaven is an entity. Heaven has a personality because heaven exists because God is. There's not enough words in the English language to describe the little words that we use as I am. But when he uses that word, he encompasses the totality of what he was, what he is, and what he shall be. And all of the reality of the magnitude, the immensity of his being. And we somehow get lost in the revelation or in the understanding or in the aspect of being Christian. God never intended for church to be the focus point or the position or the place of interest. God did not intend for church to be take the position that was in his heart in the very beginning. He did not desire church. Do you know that? Amen. God desired an entity to be made like him. Right. Huh? To look like him. However God may look, it's going to take a multitude of personalities in the Lord to display and magnify and to exemplify the fact of who God is. Right. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh my, he said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. God intended from the very beginning, Hallelujah. He loosed the word of God. My goodness. So we sometimes walk around hoping that we get this prophecy or that prophecy. Somebody might lay hands on us over here and say this about us or that about us. And all the time we have a more sure word of prophecy. In the word that was not prophesied by man, but it came out of the realm of heaven into the realm of earth. Hallelujah. It was spoken. It must have reverberated throughout the arena that is called earth. I sometimes wonder if there wasn't like a great earth shaking, like a great earthquake that was happening. And out of the earthquake, the things that God desired begin to form and function and come forth in some sort of manifestation that he began to list in things that were in the Bible with regards to creation. Oh, my goodness. Hallelujah. He said, let us make man in our own image. He loosed a word. He loosed a word. The power of that word has the ability to revive a dead man. We saw the action and the function of it in the New Testament as Christ, the Word. John chapter 1, verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word. Huh? And we have regulated it to a position of reverence in what we call the Bible. But it's something in our minds on most levels of understanding, something that is intellectually perceived. Are written by the hand of man, no matter what language it's described in. Hallelujah. And it loses something of its value. It loses something of its potency to produce and to bring forth. Hallelujah. What we have here is not just words written on a page, but we have the totality incorporated in the midst of what we call the Bible, the living reality of who the I Am is. Hallelujah. And how many of you, in some dark moment or some time of pressure and tribulation, flipped open their Bible and their eyes fell upon a particular scripture, a particular word, and as your eyes fell on it, something in the Spirit began to be quickened to you, and life came up out of those pages into the very being of your soul. No man around telling you that this is what this means and that what that means. But there was something of a clear understanding that came forth out of the midst of the written word. Amen. Stirring something in the very depth of your being, reaching down into your darkness. Huh? Lifting you up sometimes by the hair of the head. Huh? And putting your feet upon a position, a place of rock. And no matter who or what you would talk to or who would try to convince you other than what you knew or what you experienced could bring to you, the ability to deny what you heard. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. What a word. And you know, I don't know why. You know, there's in our times of pressure, we lose focus. We kind of are really, we don't really know what to focus on. Huh? And we struggle along, hoping to be able to hang on by some manner, some way, to the end of the thing, and by some measure, some manner, that God in his miraculous mercy might reach down into our circumstances to eliminate our difficulty. Quite frankly, that's how the church has used God to eliminate their difficulty. When you're in financial trouble, what do? You pray that God give you money. When you're sick, what do? You pray that God will heal your body. When you need this or you need that, what do? You pray that God will provide for you in this arena or that arena, not understanding that within you you have something of an authority. You have something of a position and a relationship. You have something that has all of God in him in you. Amen. That is able to reach forth out of the darkness in which you are in, into the realm of light. And it's not that you are to lift yourself up out of the darkness into that realm of life as much as it is for you to reach forth into the midst of the light and pull it down into the darkness. Isn't that what the scripture says? Therefore, this light shineth into the darkness to reveal what? The plan, the purpose of God. He says the image in the scriptures. I believe it's in one of the book of Corinthians when he begins to talk about the light. If our light be hid, it is therefore hid to them who are what? In what? Darkness. Huh? The Bible says in John, it says, therefore the light did shine forth into the darkness. And what happened? The darkness could not apprehend it or could not comprehend, could not lay hold upon the reality of what it was happening within its own environment. Do you know hell could not stop me from getting saved? Do you know that hell could not stop me from getting saved? Huh? Hell, do you know hell tried? Hell did everything it possibly could to subvert, to divert, and to bring to naught the word of God that was being ministered to me. Did everything he possibly could. He could not stop me from receiving the light. Therefore, this is the light that shineth upon every man that cometh into the world. Huh? Hell had no position, no authority. Because there was something in God's mind in the very beginning before hell was. Hallelujah. And that thought, that intent was something that superseded the desire of hell for me. Hallelujah. Oh my goodness. We want this, we want that, we want all of the things that we want. We can even say we want a nice church. We want to save people. All of that is well and good. But if it does not entail the fulfillment of God's desire from the very beginning, then it becomes something other than what God appreciates. Hallelujah. I am reminded of the story of the parable that Jesus told about two sons. Huh? And he said unto one, go into the field and do the labor and gather in the harvest or whatever it was. He was delegated a position of responsibility, and there was something that was required of him. And the son said, no, I will not do it. Huh? And the other said, yes, Father, I will go in and do what you have asked me to do. And he didn't do it. But the one that said he wouldn't do it did it. Which of them did the will of the Father? And so it is with you and I. As we are confronted with the word of God, with the reality of the thought and the intent, the desire that was in God's heart from the very beginning for 6,000 or 7,000 years. Man has wrestled with the concept of religion and built all sorts of things and never doing anything that would accomplish what God wanted to be done from the very beginning. And if you really want to know the truth, the whole reason that God even created time was that he might fulfill his will and his purpose in the earth and to bring forth that substance, that life that he desired in the very beginning. Huh? Isn't it amazing that in Genesis you have the story of God in his relationship with man and the birthing forth of a son. And in Revelations you have the woman standing on the church. It begins and ends with the same thought. Begins and ends with the same thought of God. God. Elohim. Hallelujah. Birthing forth a man child. Huh? Hallelujah. That's not just a segment or the thought or the will of God coming forth for a dispensation or of a people, but it is the totality, the summation of all God's efforts. In the midst of one act, in one position, one place, the birthing forth of a man child. That is the totality of what he desires. And yet we do so many other things. So many other things. The church needs to refocus itself. The churches need to understand the reason for which you and I were created was not that we might fulfill some sort of religious ambition. Amen. Do you know that the nationalities were created on the basis of rebellion? Did you know that? Huh? Oh, yes. Tower of Babel. He came down and did what? Confounded their language. They were all of one language, one mind, one thought, one intent. And that intent and that thought was not incorporated in God's desire. So God came down in the midst of that environment and stirred them up. Huh? It would be like me talk tongues to you. You wouldn't understand a word I was saying. And I don't know that it would edify you at all unless you get under the anointing that I'm under. Hallelujah. And that brings up another reason. Why do you think you talk in tongues? Do you know I can go anywhere in the world? Anywhere in the world, listen to any tongue, and I have the power to interpret it? Because why? God wants to supersede. God wants to rise up over your position, your right of inheritance, your nationality, your ethnic origin. It has nothing to do with the concept and the will of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I got all mixed up. I got all kinds of things mixed up in me that I have to overcome that are not things that God desires. Hello, that come from my ethnic origin. Huh? Hallelujah. That come from my inheritance by God, by right of blood. Hallelujah. And I have to be willing to overcome, put them down. Paul said, I count all things but dung that I might what? Win him. Why? To fulfill the purpose for which he was called. God did not call Paul just to establish the seven churches of Asia. God called Paul that he might reiterate the divine plan that was in the heart of God. When he made Paul, he saw Paul's capability to put everything, Hebrew of Hebrews. Hallelujah. He says it's nothing. Hebrew of Hebrew. You understand? I don't know if you comprehend what he was saying. He was talking about a people that were chosen by God himself. There has never been a cultural or an ethnic people other than the Jews that God has ever called unto himself and said, these are my people. And yet God said, Paul said, it's nothing. Why? Because there's a spiritual reality. There's a spiritual position of understanding that Paul had of God's thought, God's desire in the very beginning to have someone like unto himself. Huh? Well, what it must have been when God was walking in the garden with Adam. I think about that. I wonder, my goodness, what kind of relationship? What was it that was going on between the two of them? They weren't just walking down there and enjoying the scenery. It wasn't that God was saying, well, Adam, what'd you do today? Huh? How was your day, Adam? He's omnipotent. He's omnipresent. He was with Adam everywhere that Adam went. Huh? It must have been that God was in some manner, in some way, sharing with Adam the position, the place of his desire and the plan and the purposes of the things that were going to transpire. I don't know that he might not have even been telling Adam of the things to come. But what I do know is that whatever he gave Adam, Adam passed on to his grandchildren. And one in amongst all of them grabbed hold of it. Amen. Hallelujah. One amongst all of them grabbed hold of the reality that he was hearing from Adam. But there came a time when Enoch began to perceive on his own because he began to walk with God himself. Amen. And the sharing that must have went on in that little congregation. Huh? Walking with God, talking with God. Talking about the things of the heavens, talking about the great I am, talking about how the principles of the world work and the foundations of the earth and all of the mysteries that are wrapped up in the thing that we call Elohim. Talking about it until one day, in the midst of the conversation, Enoch was just parted through the veil and he walked right into the realm in which God had been talking to him about. We want to sit and think about all those negative things, or we want to think about what we want to do or what we would like to do. And unfortunately, some of us get the strength physically or financially to do those things. And when we got through doing them, we are empty. Empty. No sense of satisfaction or fullness. No sense of accomplishment, because we have not achieved the objective that God has laid down from the very beginning. God created humanity for one reason alone. There's no in-betweens. Do you know that? There's no in-betweens. I am not going to be human in the kingdom. I'm not going to retain my position of secular identity. My natural carnal self is not going to be Irish and German or Bohemian or whatever it may be. It's not going to be something of that consistency. It's going to change. Huh? Somebody mentioned it earlier today, I believe, when they were talking about change. Is this mine? Huh? Changing. Maybe it was the other day when the brother was talking. How a man is so radically, fanatically changed from one moment, from one instant, into something other than what he used to be. You know, I experienced one of those changes. Huh? Do you understand? I experienced one of those changes. Why did God touch my soul in such a manner, in such a way, to lift me up out of the hellhole that I was in and put my feet upon solid ground and give me the power to resist those things that I had no power to resist before? Why? So I could be a good Christian? That I could make it through to the end? That I could raise my family and work? Build the church, travel around the world, back and forth, here, there, and everywhere, ministering the word of God. What am I ministering? Is it not something that I am trying to apprehend in my relationship with God, then it is not something that God has put in my heart. You know, when God began to send me out, he didn't send me out for the sake of the people he sent me to. Huh? He sent me out for my deliverance. And he began to deliver me. He began to show me my propensity, my American attitude, my American independence and lack of dependence, my pride and my position of strength and my ability and my intellectual, however limited it might be. I came to a revelation about myself that if it wasn't for the sake of God, then my neck, as that jackass, was broken in the Old Testament. That would have been my fate. When God began to show me the position of ministry, oh my goodness. And he uses the ox. Have you ever considered the ox? Slow, plodding, kind of wrapped up in themselves. You got to take the whip or the stick or the goad to get it to do what you want it to do. Always in harness, always bearing these loads, as though, and somebody always telling it what to do. That's ministry. That's the position of ministry. Hello? That's the position. You don't want to desire to be in a position of exaltation. I want the title of bishop. No. You say, I don't want to be bishop. I just want somebody to recognize the fact that I got an anointing. Amen. Hallelujah. If your anointing is not producing within you the substance of the reality of what God desired in the beginning, the substance of the thing that you call ministry is of no value to you or anyone else. Your ministry must bring change first in you. Amen. Hallelujah. 7,000 years, God has been working in the church to bring forth a viable, living ministry. 7,000 years, and we've only seen little splatterings and spots of it throughout time. Men that had sold out to God, They didn't care where they slept, what they ate, what they wore. Hallelujah. All they cared about was the burden that God had put upon their soul, the burden to press through the realm of carnality and flesh and to touch the living reality of that burden that was in their heart. Some of them had the burden for souls. Some of them had the burden for building the church. Some of them had the burden of ministry in foreign lands, in jungles, and all kinds of things. What would make a man who has $1 million in the bank go and live in China? Give it all away. What would make a man do that? You and I would call him crazy. The world would call him crazy. Oh, you got to care for your family. God will take care of my family. That's what he said. You know, he was 12 years, I believe. 12 years apart from his wife. She was sick. He had to send her home so she wouldn't die. And he expended himself in the midst of what makes a man do that? Huh? We want to preach from our air-conditioned rooms in an environment that is safe. Hallelujah. Brethren, the church is really not where it needs to be. I'm talking about this church. I'm talking about the church that has the word of sonship. I'm talking about, we're talking about sonship as though it's some little medal that like an army person would pin upon their breast. Huh? Hallelujah. Well, the church needs to get down to business. The church needs to find out come to some conclusion as to why they were created. Why were you created? To make money? And what do you do with your money? What do you do with it? What does the church do with its money? Is it propagating the kingdom? Is it bringing forth the reality of God in the midst of the land and in the different places that God is sending his ministry into? Is it propagating? Is it purposing to bring forth something of a reality? Or is it just making you and I more comfortable? Giving us a better car to drive, giving us better clothes to wear, giving us better food to eat, or a better house to live in. What is your money doing for the kingdom of God? You know the right reason why we don't spend the money on the kingdom of God? Because we don't understand the concept or the reality. We do not know the heart or the desire that is in God's soul with regards to the production and the producing and the bringing forth. Hallelujah. He did not do what he did on the basis of just doing it because he had no other way to do it. He did it that he might demonstrate the reality of what is in his heart. Amen. Book after book, book after book, book after book is written on the basis of the desire that God desired sons. Amen. Hallelujah. And if that isn't enough for you, you can go into the New Testament. And it says of Jesus that he was what? The firstborn among many sons. If you're brethren, you got to be sons. If you're born of the lineage of Yeshua, you can go into Matthew, the first chapter, and go into the revelation of the 42nd generation. It's a generation of sons. It's a generation of people that manifest the will of God to the extent and the totality of what they have been given. Hallelujah. And we have been given more than any other generation that I know about on the magnitude of scale as far as knowledge is concerned. I am convinced of one thing. Hallelujah. If I am not convinced of any other, if I can grasp hold of the reality of the word that God is speaking to me in this hour, it will give me the ability to fulfill the will of God with regard to my position and his desire for me to achieve that place that he created for me in the very beginning. Do you know that God's word is eternal? Do you know that? That when it returns, it goes out to him, it does not come back to him void. It comes back fulfilled in the totality of what he expected it to be when he sent it out. And when he spoke in Genesis 1, 26, it wasn't just a scripture and to designate the opening of time and the fact that man was coming into existence. What it was that God was proclaiming his desire that would work, reach down through year after year, hundreds and thousands of years down into my time. Prick my heart. Prick your heart. Give you an insatiable appetite for something other than what you got. Amen. And begin to make you somewhat maybe weird or fanatical. You know, some of the people that they called religious fanatics, they weren't really religious fanatics. They were people who had got a hold of God. And they became so abnormal. They became, have you ever been with somebody who has such an insatiable appetite with souls that he embarrasses you? Have you? Just anybody and everywhere, and sometimes he starts talking to someone that you in a place that you wish that they just would shut up. Why? Everybody's looking at you. Huh? Of course, you don't have that problem, I'm sure. Huh? Why? Why? Because God has put something in their heart, and there has been a breaking forth and a breaking out in the realm of eternity that gave them the desire to see this one saved and that one saved, and they were doing everything and anything possible to achieve the objective. We sit back in our theology, smug and assured that because we have a certain awareness, a certain knowledge, we're going to be okay. It's almost like rapture, you know. Having a certain knowledge that because you have it, you're safe. You can do what you want, when you want, however you want, because you got the word. Oh, yes, I'm God's little honey. Showed me the end time. Showed me the coming forth of the sons of God. Sons of God are coming forth. Huh? You know that my knowledge without power to change is of no value to me or anyone else. Do you know it? And you know what? Men have built churches, mega churches. Men have mega followings of people built upon some little teeny-witty aspect of God's love. Oh, you want a big church? Just start talking about God's love. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, God's love. Anything is allowable. Anything is permissible because God loves you. Huh? Flesh likes that. Flesh likes that. Flesh don't want to hear, as Christ was crucified, so must you. I don't want to be crucified. I don't know. I don't want to be crucified. Everything in my natural being is repulsed by the thought of being crucified. Stripped naked. A man that has a sense of decency. A man that has any kind of God in him. Dresses appropriately. Because he's ashamed to be uncovered. He's ashamed. And yet they took Jesus, they stripped him naked. Huh? Exposed him. Oh, yes. He said, as they have done unto the master, what shall they do unto the servant? Huh? If they do this to the tree that is green, what are they going to do when the tree is dry? Huh? Oh, we want to hear about the goodness of God and the prosperity that God gives us for the sake of our being comfortable. You know, some of us are going to have to answer to the call of God with regards to the fact of what he's given us and what we've done with it or what we haven't done with it. Hallelujah. There's a plan. There's a purpose that God had from the very beginning. that has not yet been fulfilled or come to fruition. God did not desire just to have a man manifesting the characteristics of God. He wanted a people, a multi-membered, multifaceted, multi-body people that would come together and that could flow. We had the illustration of it in Acts. Someone mentioned it earlier. How does it say that we were all in one accord? Huh? You know, if I preach like they preach in Acts, I'd probably be accused of picking your pocket. God had a plan. God had a purpose. God had a word. He loosed that word. In the beginning was the word. And the word was with God. Where in the beginning? Genesis 1:26 for one place. Huh? It says that all things were created by him and nothing was created without him. Huh? Come on! Did he create it? What does God need this for? With his trees and his rocks, in his valleys and his mountains. What does he need it for? He's eternal. Hello? And yet he created it all and put you and I in the midst of it. Why? Huh? So that we, and then give us a revelation of something other than the environment in which we are living in. Can you fathom God? Huh? He gives us all these distractions. Put you in the middle of it. And they're tapping your shoulder. Hey, look over here. Hey, look over here. Hey, look over here. Look how beautiful this is. Oh, look how grander that is. Look how good this is. Oh, I could do that. I could do this. I could do over here, and I could have that. In the midst of all of that, God put us. And in the midst of it, he begins to tap on your shoulder. There's something other than what you see. Something other than what you're hearing. There's something out here that goes beyond the fact of the reality of what you're hearing and seeing and feeling. Hmm? Hallelujah. Everything in the world, you can have everything in the world, and it will bring absolutely, oh, it's easily said, you say, but it will bring no satisfaction. None. I knew a man, rich, could have had anything he wanted. Come on, could have had any kind of life that he wanted, could have done anything he could have done. That could be done, could do anything he could do. Hallelujah. He was rich all of his life, his adult life, rich. He died a poor, miserable, blind, lonely, broken man. Rich. What did his money do? He had no family. He had no cognizant reality of even his circumstance. Bedridden. Someone else waiting on him. Hallelujah. And you know what? Someone else got all of his money. If a man gained the world and loses his soul, you know, it's kind of scary, this revelation, this understanding that God is giving me. It scares me a little bit. Because there's something of an onus, there's something of a responsibility that God is putting on me. When the Bible says that I am supposed to work out my salvation, huh? With joy and leaping around and carefree? Huh? Absolutely not. But it says that you must work out your salvation with fear and trembling. You know, I was sitting in church the other day, and there was a sister that was giving a lesson to the children, and I got a revelation. Oh, hallelujah. But you know something? That just made me a little more fearful and a little more apprehensive. She was talking out of Revelation on the stations are the words, the different words that were given to the church. And all of a sudden, my eyes fastened on that scripture in Revelation that talks about the fifth church, I believe it was. That speaks about the fifth position, the fifth place in the tabernacle, which is the altar of incense. Where did we just hear that? Did we just not hear something about that? Every man has lost his life in the tabernacle, has lost it where? At the fifth position, the fifth article, the piece of furniture that is called the altar of incense. Oh my. And I read there, he said, to him that overcometh in this position, this place, he says, why, will give to them a white garment and will not blot their name out of the book of life. What does that mean? Read it in the converse. If you don't make it to that position, you have the potential and the possibility. If you don't measure up, you have the probability of not getting your name established in an eternal way, an eternal measure. Go to Revelations and read it. This is not Burt's philosophy. This is not Burt's doctrine. This is not Burt's theology. This is what God has spoken. God has written. He penned it with the pen of men and wrote it in his blood. Oh, glory to God. I cannot hardly comprehend men as they take God and begin to utilize God to facilitate their desire and their insatiable appetite for the position of power and preeminence. I cannot hardly comprehend that, except for when I look in the mirror. And see the humanity that is so prevalent and so in such a place of preeminence within the reflection that is staring back at me. Oh, God is so good to me. He is so good to me. I look in the mirror. Sometimes I see Dad. I said, oh, God, deliver me from Dad. Not that I didn't love my father, but I don't want to be like him. I'm so glad that he brought me forth. I'm so glad that I had the life and the ability to come forth in life, in breath. Hallelujah, to take that breath of life and live, that gave me the opportunity to meet with God one day. Yes. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Sometimes I look in the brother, my mirror, and I see my brother, my older brother. I don't want to be like my older brother. I don't want the traits and the characteristics of my family predominantly staring back at me, pointing their finger at me, and say, I told you so. Amen. This is your heritage. This is your place. I say, Lord God, deliver me. Amen. Deliver me. Amen. Deliver me. Of my propensity to be Asbill or Friokel or whatever else is in my bloodline, deliver me. Don't want to be like that. I don't want that image superimposed. I don't want the veil of Moses put upon the revelation of Christ that is within me. I don't want my humanity in a position or a place of preeminence that clouds or shades does not allow the reflection of what Christ in me, my hope of glory. Because you see, really, that is God's intent. That's God's desire. That's God's will. That's God's desire. And he's working everything. Do you know all these men, these women, these children, they lived, they died, they wandered around and had homes for caves, had caves for homes, and they were destitute. For my benefit, I am reaping most of all the toil of their labor. faithful in the aspect of the idea that we sometimes think is an abstract, mythical, somewhere out there thought of God. You know, when you talk to men that have seen God, we can either believe it or disbelieve it. Makes no difference, except for the fact that when I talk to men that have seen God, it makes something in me want to see God. Amen. Moses knew the penalty. Moses knew the law. Moses knew that no man could come into the presence of God and live. He knew it. If nobody else knew it, Moses knew it. Huh? And yet he said, I want to see your face. I want to look into your countenance. Huh? I want to know you. I want the experience and the revelation of who you are. Moses knew. Do you understand me? Paul knew it. Paul had a total understanding of the fact that God was so holy that he was what? A consuming fire. And yet the one place he desired to be was in the midst of that fire. Hebrew children knew about it, at least in theory. But what they knew in theory became a revelation on the facets of their position, their place, their stamina, their integrity in God. Hallelujah! One of the sad lackings in the church today is the virtue of integrity. We're more willing to believe something bad than something good. How much do you want to see God? Are you willing to want God so much, so absolutely, totally desiring to see him that you're willing to die? Thou fool, knowest not that unless a corn of wheat, what? Fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. Has no substance, has no value. What good is a corn? One little piece of corn. What good is it? Huh? It's of no value. It can't feed me, much less you and me. But if you put it into the ground, 50 bushels of corn, a bushel of corn, 50 pounds of corn will produce anywhere from 100 to 150 pounds. And I've heard of it producing up to 200 pounds of bushels of corn per acre. Huh? Hallelujah. Okay, praise the Lord. That was a warm-up. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Genesis. Chapter 25. You know, whenever I get to thinking of myself more highly than I ought, number one, God is always to remind me. He's always faithful to remind me. And number two, I think about the devil. And I think about the devil because I don't want to be called stupid. Hello? I don't want to be called stupid. I just think about the devil. And you think about it a minute. Here is a being who has, in the presence of God, knows something of the reality of God all around him. He has a position of magnificence as no other angel has. He has a position, a place of preeminence. And he knows that God, in his godness, is omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent. He knows that. And yet, knowing all of that, he thinks he can beat him. Stupid. stupid, not only thinks that he can beat him, but he has to play the rules, the game, according to the rules that God lays down. Stupid. And yet, that's the way the devil works. Hello? God set the boundaries. God set the stage. Hallelujah. And he gave the devil permission to go ahead and do whatever he wanted to do. Now, Brother Lucille, do you think he knew the lamb was slain from the foundation of the earth? The Bible says the lamb, what the solution to the problem, the card, the trump card that God had up his sleeve or under the table or on the table, I don't know where it was, but wherever it was the fact that the lamb was slain from the foundation of the earth. Not only is he dumb, he's a loser. And you know why I think about the devil? Because I find myself doing the same thing. Somehow going to circumvent God's plan. Somehow going to circumvent God's will. Somehow moving this or moving that. Trying to manipulate my circumstances, my situations, to get something that I want that God doesn't want me to have. Be in a place that I don't need to be in. Hallelujah. You know, I know where I'm supposed to be. Maybe I'm one of the luckiest persons in the whole world. Most fortunate. And I'm happy with it. Do you understand? I'm happy with it. Well, sometimes. I'm not quite so happy. But nevertheless, I know the will of God for my life. I know what the will of God is for my life. I'm content to be there. I don't want to be anything else. Amen. I don't want anything. I don't want something higher, bigger, more important, more exalted. I don't want to be in that position. I want what God has given me. Amen. And I have trouble fulfilling it. Of course, you don't. You're completely happy. You're completely satisfied with whatever it is that God has given you. If we know what it really is. Huh? Hallelujah. Genesis chapter 25. I want to start at verse 20. And Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel, the Syrian of Padanaram, the sister of Laban, the Syrian. What a mixture. I could almost put myself in there. Huh? Hallelujah. We used to say that we're kind of like Heinz 57. A little bit of German, a little bit of English, and a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and no good. Hallelujah. And it says, Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife. How many of you know that there is an intercessory arm of God's government in the land? That all they are doing is interceding and travailing before the Lord that God bring forth in the barrenness of humanity the fruit that God desired from the very beginning. How many of you know that? Huh? As we wander around, sometimes in a confused state, huh? Doing this and doing that and not fulfilling the will of God. I don't know that David Brainerd, 28 years old, he died 28, and they wrote a book about a 28-year-old man who lived, what, maybe 10 years? Huh? His lifespan was very short. His service of God, he would have had to start very early. Huh? He was a man that had tuberculosis, that had a burden from God for the American Indian, and he burned himself out. He burned bright. He burned hard. and he died. 28 years old. Huh? 28 years old. He touched something of a reality. He's preached about, he's written about. He's an inspiration for missionaries. He's an inspiration for children as well as adults. There's something about his life. 28 years of age. 28 years of age. Huh? With tuberculosis. We would have been spending our time in the hospital trying to get cured. You know where his hospital was? In the midst of a snowbank. Fevered. Huh? Racking his body. Going out in the midst of night, getting down on his face in the midst of the snow and beginning to pray for salvation of these souls that were lost and wandering around in the mouth of hell, was reaching out to gobble them up. We will use every medical facility available to us to get ourselves healed. And then we might go. Something of a reality, something of a word that this man received. Somebody was praying that God would bring forth such a man as this man. Huh? And so it is that God has his intercessors in the earth praying for the coming forth of the desire that God has for the church. God doesn't want church, God wants sons. The church moved. The sun moved from off of the moon onto the woman. Huh? And then the sun, the reality of that move was for that woman to bring forth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isaac was 40 years old and he took Rebekah to wife. God has taken a wife for 7,000 years. Trying to bring forth the reality of what he desired in the very beginning. Hallelujah. And Isaac was 40 years old and he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel. Hallelujah. Verse 21, and Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren. You're barren? Huh? Barren spiritually? Huh? Barren in the spirit? Not producing Christ. There's a necessity of a position of travail. There's a necessity of a position of recognizing the fact that what you are producing is not what needs to come forth. There needs to be the issue of the fruition of God's will for you, that you manifest what God had in mind in the very beginning, way back there when he prophesied. God prophesied. I get discouraged. I go back and read what God prophesied. You know that prophecy was for me? Do you know that? In the dispensation of the fullness of time, God is going to bring forth all those things that are in heaven and those things that are in earth. Why? Together in one. For what purpose? To manifest the original intent that God had when he said in the beginning, let us make man. Let us make man. Let us make man in our image. Fashion him and form him. And not only are we going to fashion and form him in our image, but we're going to put within him our likeness. Oh, hallelujah. I don't know what we're waiting for. Quite frankly, we're kind of waiting for the magic wand to be waved over us, when all of the time the thing that has the power to change us is in us. It says, oh, little children, I travail again. How? Why? That Christ be formed in you. It is Christ in you. The hope of glory. It's not Burt Asbill and all of his ethnic origin, his position of preeminence and intellectual power, strength that has the ability to magnify and to bring all of this thing that God is doing about. It's Christ within me. John had the revelation, did he not? I must decrease. There is a decreasing of this personality. There is a decreasing of this nature. There is a decreasing of these wants and these desires. There is a decreasing of my nationality. I am so privileged to live where I have lived and grow up. I am privileged. But it's like grave clothes. Do you understand? Like grave clothes that are to be shed for the newness of the thing that God has had in me. He has deposited something within me. Even as Rebecca, as Isaac was travailing for his wife, so what must we come before the throne and begin to travail through the Father that he bring forth within us the revelation of what it is to be a son in his sight, in my set of circumstances. I have to manifest that sonship where I am. Do you understand? I have to be a testimony to the generations of my inheritance that are around me and my progeny that is coming after me. I don't want my children or my grandchildren to walk in the steps that I had to walk. Amen. I don't believe there's time for one thing. Yes. Hallelujah. There's some of this overcoming that I have to do for the sake of my children as well as my grandchildren. You know, the scripture says that the inheritance that is mine not goes to my children, but my grandchildren. Do you know that? Huh? That's what the scripture says. So there's an inheritance that I have in God. I don't want to give it. What are they going to get? A worn out car, a pair of worn out shoes? Huh? And clothes? That are worn out? Is that what I'm wanting to give them? Or maybe thousands and millions of dollars and houses and lands and cattle and horses and barns and all of the things that man thinks this seems to think is so important. Oh, let me carve out a little nick of myself. Hallelujah. And then when they die and they pass away, right upon the tomb, may he rest in peace. How could I rest in peace? Knowing I had not fulfilled the obligations. You see, life eternal is something of a concept that is foreign to us. We're fragile. We're so fragile. Everything breakable. If it's not breakable, it gets worn outable. Huh? We are so fragile. We are so absolutely frail. We have no concept of the reality of the eternity. What is it that I can pass on to my children and my children's children that will be eternal if it is not God's desire for them to be sons? I have a responsibility to teach them standing up, sitting down, walking around. I have the responsibility to monitor their actions and to go to God. You know, some things I can't do for my children. And one of the things I cannot do is make them righteous. But I have a God. Amen. I have a God who desires them to be much more righteous than I could ever hope for them to be. And I can go to God and I can say to God, I want you to make them righteous. And you know what? God will make them righteous. How he does it is none of my business. Now, I may have to stand a little pain and travail and suffering. Oh, yes. Nothing comes without a price, brethren. Huh? Nothing comes without a price. And sometimes we are not willing to pay the price. You know, the Lord used to handle my children a whole lot harder than I would ever handle them. I'm telling you, if I did what God did to them, I'd get accused of child abuse. Hmm? Oh, yes. They would have the government knocking on my door. Huh? Hallelujah. I had a son that was rebelling against me, and he was too big, too strong. Huh? I was looking like this instead of like this. Was rebelling against me, and I went to God about it. I said, God, I dedicated this child to you when he was a baby. And I have reared him in the admonition of the Lord. And he is now out here doing all of this stupid stuff. Rebelling against me, will not listen to me. I need you to deal with him. Huh? Well, God dealt with him, rolled him down the mountain on his face. Come home skinned and scattered and torn up and bleeding. No broken bones. Thank God. Hallelujah. And I said, did you learn? And he says, yes, Daddy, I'm sorry. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We have to have a concept of what it is that God wants of us. You know, I'm not knocking anybody that's got a burden to feed the hungry. If that's what they have, let them fulfill it. Let them do it to the total, absolute capacity in which they are able to do it. And I say, praise the Lord. Bless them in the name of Jesus. And I tell you that whatever their reward is in the fulfilling of the thing that they are doing that God has spoken to them to do, God will reward them. They will be blessed. They will be happy. God will be happy. Everybody's going to be happy. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the intent that we have, the knowledge and the awareness that we have of God's desire. You know, somebody said it here earlier. We are designed to save the world. We have trouble enough saving ourselves, much less the world. Now we have a lot of people sticking their nose in other people's businesses, thinking that they are able to save the business. And they do it without God or the inspiration of God, and all they end up in is in a bigger mess than what they started with. Huh? Hallelujah. God is able to handle his affairs. I'm not talking about that. What I'm talking about is you and I that have had a glimpse of heaven, have a glimpse into the mind of God. Do you understand? Do you understand that we have had the privilege of looking into God's thoughts? And in some of the meetings I've been in, and I'm sure you have been in them too, we have walked with God. Huh? I said it earlier. These meetings have been filled with the authority and the presence and the reality of God. We have seen God move in such a divine, miraculous way. Amen. Healing people. Moving in those circumstances that were impossible. You think devil likes that? You think he's really happy about you all? Well, if you think so, wait till you get home. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There is a spirit of God that is hovering over the people. It is hovering with a cry of intercession and a cry of supplication, being entreated and trying to entreat God that he might prepare the environment in which Rebecca could bring forth the seed of the thing that was on his heart to do. Ha! God desires sons. Do you hear me? He wants sons. He doesn't want robots, puppets, or anything else. He wants sons. Amen. You know, God taught me a very valuable lesson. My father was quite well-to-do, and we always took it for granted. I had just about everything that you could think about. I had my first car at 16. Told if I graduated with good grades, he'd buy me a new car. I graduated with bad grades and still got the car. You think I appreciated it? Absolutely none. Tore it up, wrecked it. Oh, well, get another one, throw it away in the trash can. And sometimes that's how we treat God. That's how we look at God. That's how we think about God. Not everybody, but some of us do. And that's how we behave in the presence of God. Hallelujah. God wants sons. God wants for us to desire him. But in my relationship with God, in my relationship with life, somewhere along that line, hallelujah, I met God and God began to change my way of thinking. And one of the things he did was to change my position of response to my father. And my dad went through my family went through a very trying time, a very hard time. And dad had to begin to close out all of his interests, all of his business things, and all of that. And there was no one to help him now. You understand? Because he wasn't as prosperous as he used to be. And some of the other siblings couldn't get what they wanted to get, so they weren't interested in helping him. Because I found God, because God was doing something in my heart, God stirred my heart to offer my services to him free of charge. Something that was unheard of up until that point. Well, Dad, I'll go and do it. How much are you going to pay me? Free of charge. Hallelujah. And I have to help, and I had to help him willingly, wanting to do it in my own strength, my own volition, offering myself to him. That's what God wants. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm so glad for my experiences in the Lord. Another experience is when I was very, very young. I was about 6 years old. Dad put me to work. My job was sweeping the floor. I'm the heir to the business. I know all the benefits of having the business. When I'm a little boy back there in the service apartment sweeping the floor. And you know, I swept the floor a long time. Year after year. Year after year. And you would think that my attitude was something, oh, this is so great. It wasn't great. I'm the son, and I'm pushing a broom. Huh? Come on, Dad. Give me something more responsibility. I'm heir. I'm your son. Oh, yes. Okay. He put me in the refinishing department. Sanding. And I think he gave special instructions to my supervisor. Make sure he sands everything. And I sanded and I sanded and I sanded and I sanded and I sanded. I must have sanded my fingers down to the bone. Huh? Not a week, not a month, but year after year after year. Huh? Hallelujah. I need a raise, Dad, don't you think? I need to be exalted in my position. I'm your son. Huh? So he gave me a promotion. He put me in the delivery department. Uncrating. And cleaning up boxes. And cleaning up refrigerators to be delivered. And doing all of the assembling of parts. Hallelujah. I'm thinking I'm destined for something greater than this. Hallelujah. We are a lot like that with God. We are a lot like that with God. Not understanding the reality of God's heart with regards to us. We mumble, we grumble, we complain. Of course, you don't do that. Huh? You lament your condition, your position, the place of the aspect of the reality of your circumstances so more real to you that God become something of a figment of your imagination. Somewhere, oh yes, somewhere out there in a great bit of time, we are going to see you, God, in that last day, at that last drop. Just pray that I can hang on to the end. That's not an attitude of sonship. That's not an attitude of the reality of God the Father. God the Father. God the Father. We squander, as it were, sometimes our inheritance, so much like the prodigal son, are the lavishness of our own appetites. Things are coming and going, and we're not even conscious of the fact that the reality of the end of time is coming upon us. I know one thing that 9/11 did. You know, I travel a lot. And I don't take flying for granted anymore. I mean, I don't take it for granted. I pray over the car that's going to the airport. I pray over the airport that I'm going in. I pray over the plane. I'm on the plane. I'm praying. I pray for the taking off. I'm praying for the flight over. I'm praying for the landing. I'm praying. Because I know one thing, the devil don't like me. And I want to tell you something, if you didn't know it, the devil don't like you either. He don't like you. You're a threat. You are a threat. Now, you may not think that you're much of a threat to the devil, but I want to tell you, to whom much is given, much is required. And there is something of a knowledge and authority that God has given you that he has not necessarily given to anybody else. Even by the fact or the foot of the thing that you're sitting here listening to this ranting, raving maniac. And that makes you a threat. You're a liability. Because if you ever come to grasp, if you ever come to a position where you begin to comprehend the magnitude of the power that is in you, if you ever comprehend the desire that God has put upon you, the favor in which he looks upon you, if you ever comprehend it, that where you begin to reach out for it, you have something in your grasp that can destroy him. I don't know how it is that God sees, that the devil sees the calling and the election that are upon the individuals, other than the fact that God gives him that awareness. Huh? Hallelujah. And, but in any way that he can, he begins to move, begins to destroy that potentiality, that aspect of life. He begins to move to try to destroy it, to keep it from coming to a place of fulfillment, because he knows that if this child, this baby, gets the revelation, he is done, he's toast. Amen. He's finished.
Right.
And we think reading and writing is so important. And we teach it, we go great lengths to teach our children to be intelligent. And we leave out the most essential, vital ingredient of teaching them what it is that God desires for them to be. You know, when I was growing up my children, I was a carpenter. I was a good carpenter. I love carpentry. I love it. I eat it. I could eat it and live in it. I could do it. And because I love it so much, I wanted all my kids to be carpenters. Hallelujah. What is God's desire for you and your children and your grandchildren if it is not for them to have what he wants you to have? Hallelujah. Come on, brethren. We're talking about theology of God. We're talking about the vital. It is what started the church in the very beginning. It wasn't the need to just save souls from hell. I'm not coming against that thought. We need soul winners. We need people that are pursuing after souls. But I'm telling you, that wasn't the intent or the original thought. That was a byproduct of the relationship that God wanted. Do you know that everything that God is, that we have made a church out of it? Do you know that? Take salvation. We have denomination upon denomination that is built on the premise of just getting saved. Huh? How about being filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost? We have had churches upon churches upon churches that are built on the premise of just being filled with the Holy Ghost and nothing more. Built our kingdoms, built our positions of preeminence, and exalted ourselves in thrones of baptism of the Holy Ghost. We have taken every piece and part of God and made something out of it as the end product of the thing that God desires, but God did not desire that to be a stopping place. He meant it to be an experience on the way up into the realm of heaven, building block upon block, salvation as well as sanctification and consecration. Where is sanctification and consecration, by the way? Be ye holy even as your Father in heaven is holy. How do you justify some of the things we do with the fact that you are supposed to be holy as God is holy?
Oh my.
And it's not that we don't have that the goal is unattainable. That is not the point. The point is realizing the position, the place of our weakness and the desire that God has for us, and knowing that in God's desire, He is giving us the ability to comprehend. Paul had it the different way. He said, that I might what? Apprehend. Yes, know Him. And that I might apprehend that for which I was apprehended for. Why were you apprehended? Just to get you into heaven? Is that all you were apprehended for? Well, praise the Lord. Maybe you will get there. But if you were apprehended for something more than what, than that thought, then that is the thing that you and I should be pressing for. I wasn't called just to get to heaven. I don't really even need to get to heaven, because the Bible says, I have heaven within me. I don't think I'm preaching false doctrine. I don't think I am deceived, that I am deluded into thinking something other than what God wants for His people. Hallelujah. You know, the story that brother told the other day is a common story about people who have been convicted of the Lord. The brother, when he was talking about the accident, because you know what? He would have been dead. You know that? The word to him, it was the last time. That was the word. Do you hear me? If he would not have done what God wanted him to do when he did it, he would be a dead man and very possibly be in hell. Hell is a reality. You don't think hell is a reality? Oh, boy. Hallelujah. Hell is a reality. And I don't know what we think. There's only two objectives. Did you know that? Two. Sorry. If you're disappointed or you think it's unfair, I didn't write the rules. I didn't make the laws. I didn't lay down the principles. There's only two objectives. That is heaven, that is hell. There are two words that are being spoken, as is illustrated by this story in Genesis. As Isaac entreated the Lord, it says that the Lord was faithful to Isaac's entreaty, and Rebekah conceived, and the children struggled together within her, and she said, if it be so, why am I thus? And she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be the stronger, and the other people and the elder shall serve the younger. Hallelujah. Two words were released in the very beginning. Two words that made two positions, two destinies, two destinations. There was the word that God spoke to the heavenlies when He brought forth the idea, the thought that He wanted to bring forth something in His image, something in His likeness. And the other thought is in the aspect of what the devil spoke to Eve in the fact of countering the word that God spoke to Adam and Eve. Two words. That's all you have. That's all. That's the epitome of the totality of the total existence of humanity. Two words. One heaven, one hell. That's all there is. That's all there is. There's no in between. There's no middle line. There's no compromise. You know, compromise is not a word. That is called a God word. The Bible says that there is no shadow of turning in Him. It says that God is what? The same today as He was yesterday and will be tomorrow. God cannot lie. God is eternal. God is absolute. We have eradicated and erased the necessities for absolutes. In a theology of tolerance. Oh, we can tolerate the thing until God moves. Oh, poppycock.
No, sir. We have a responsibility to ensue and manifest righteousness.
Yes, amen.
You know, God knows I don't. And therefore, I have to be righteous before Him in all of my relationships. God knows who's going to make it and who isn't. But I still have to be righteous. I still have to be true to my convictions. True to my convictions. Huh? And my convictions must be based upon what is written in this word. Not what I think about it. There are certain things that I can do that says that I, doing them, will forfeit my right into the kingdom of heaven. Huh? And lying is one of them. It doesn't seem like such a bad thing to me to lie. Oh boy. But it says in the Bible, liars will not inherit the kingdom of God. It puts it right up there with fornication and all other manner of sexual perversion. Hello? And yet, we have this gospel of tolerance. Hallelujah. I think that we need some good old Holy Ghost revival. I think that we need some good old Holy Ghost conviction that gets us down on our face before God. And as we begin to intercede with four things and four people, amen. Hallelujah, amen. We will begin to see a change. Amen. Because it's God's desire that those things be changed. Amen. Hallelujah. Paul said it a different way. If you want to turn with me over into Romans. Romans, the 7th chapter. Verse 15, chapter 7. For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would do, that do I not, but that I hate, that I do. What a revelation Paul is making. What a confession he's making. It's inconceivable for me to be able to think that the man that wrote so many books of the Bible could find himself in such a position. What say it of my position? What says it of my place of weakness? And what then is therefore my responsibility in the aspect of what God is saying through this man? Oh my. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. Why do we think that our flesh is so good? Why do we think that our culture is so fine? Why is it that we have such a pride and a position of preeminence in our thinking about our nationality? If what Paul is saying with regards to his position, his place, is such a bad thing for him to have to deal with, and he calls it sin. Sin. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's not talking, and he's not preaching a gospel of tolerance. Do you know that? Because you have to go back up into the scripture and you find out what Paul said about sin. He says, therefore, having this grace, having this position, this place of benefit, and this grace that God has given, shall we yet continue in sin? God said, God forbid. And yet we have a gospel of tolerance. Not only to those that are around us, but because of the tolerance that we allow as far as our own appetites are concerned. We have a gospel of tolerance. And we live one day in, one day out, one day in, one day out. We go to church and we praise the Lord and we sing songs and we preach and we have this and we have that. And we go home and nothing is changed. Nothing has changed. We're still having the same contentions, the same arguments, the same place, positions of contention and strife and all of the things that go with hell and the desolation and the destitution of marriage. Huh? I don't know. I've done a lot of counseling, a lot of talking to people, and the major problem that I find in all of it is that you have two people insisting upon their own will. You can trace it back. I don't care if it's alcohol, drugs, or whatever it may be, or contention and strife in the homes, and she won't do this, and he won't do that. All of it goes back to the position of personal preference and the will of the individuals involved and the place of preeminence that each of them want. That was the lie that was spoken of in the beginning. Did you know that? When the devil came to Eve, he said, you shall be as God. What does that mean? It means you're going to be in a position of preeminence. So if you take this God and put him in this domain, and you take another God and put it in the same domain, what are you going to have? You're going to have a position of strife and contention over the territory. And the one God is going to have to submit or serve the other God. Because in the essence of God, that's what God is. A position of being a preeminence. Amen. Hallelujah. And if you will examine that, I hope we got the concept this morning on the word. Huh? You see, the devil had to bring doubt and unbelief on the word that had been spoken previously, in order to interject his word, and that word would become the preeminent and dominant factor and the focus of the woman. Do you understand what I'm saying? God gave them a word in the beginning. First he says, I'm going to make you in my image, in my likeness. And then he tells them, go out, subdue, and bring and take dominion, bringing everything into subjection to you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Now, and then he said, oh, yes. Oh, by the way, you can eat of the tree of the life, but don't eat of the tree of the good and evil. In the day that you eat it, you die. You die. Word of God coming. You die. What do you mean? He says, you won't achieve the objective that I have set for you. Huh? So the devil comes. Hath God said? He's got to do something about the word. You hear? He's got to bring some sort of shadow of doubt upon the word. What does the devil do to you? You're a son? You can't have sonship on this side of the veil. Sonship is something that is set for another realm, another position, another place. Look at you. Who do you think you are? That's sacrilegious to think that you can elevate yourself with the level of God. And your own soul begins to take up stones to stone you.
the devil does it another way. He brings up all of your inadequacies, all of your failures, and he begins to parade them out there in front of you. Huh? Oh, you said you were going to do this. You remember that? You said you were going to do that. Well, you haven't done that. And you said you were going to do this. Well, you haven't done that either. And you said you were going to achieve this. Well, you haven't got that either. Where is this thing called sonship? The Word of God says, shake yourself. Amen. Shake yourself like a dog shakes himself coming. Have you ever watched a horse? After it's gone down and wallowed in the sand and the dirt, have you ever watched it? Every portion and every particle of that horse shakes. It starts at his nose and just works all the way down his back. And even his tail gets out there going like this. Huh? And that's what that word means when it says to shake yourself of the dirt, of the dust, and what? Rise up! The other word that God prophesies to us in the New Testament is the word that is found when Jesus is talking to his disciples about the end of time. He says, when you see these things, he says, drawing nigh, he says, rejoice. But he also tells us to flee where? To the mountains. What is he talking about? You think these little hills around here are going to be any kind of refuge for you? You ever been in an earthquake? Don't want to be anywhere where there's rocks and mountains. Because I found out rocks and mountains, they don't stay placed. They come down. Huh? We need to shake ourselves of our humanity. Huh? Shake ourselves of our position, our place of cultural, ethnic origin. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. I got German in me. Oh, God. Deliver me. You know where God sends me? Germany. I joined the service. I'm not even a Christian. Where does he send me? He sent me to Germany. Hmm? And I'm confronted with the German mentality, the German understanding. Well, you know, they can get mad at me if they want, but I'm just talking about myself. Deliver me of my Germanness. My Germanness is not going to do God any good. It came forth in the midst of rebellion. Do you hear me? It came forth out of rebellion. Against God. It is of no value to God. Oh, I'm American. I'm American. Land of the free. Just try to encompass me or enclose me a little bit. Huh? Try to restrict me. I'm free. I got a free, I'm free born. Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Don't get on my space. Don't get on my territory. Huh? I have certain rights, inalienable. I have certain inalienable rights. You can't talk to me that way. You can't do that to me. You can't act that way. I have certain rights, and I demand that you treat me with respect because I am an American. Of course, you're not that way. You probably don't have that problem. Listen to me, brethren. It's not that I don't appreciate the fact that I was born in America, but America is coming to the end of its days. And if you don't think that's not going to affect the whole world, you've got another thing coming. Because it says the merchants of the world are going to lament over the falling of Babylon. Huh? And if you think that they're not going to be partakers of the judgment, you're mistaken. Because the judgment that starts in America is going to spread out into every nation, every nationality, every tongue. It's going to touch every individual, every life, every aspect of life that people live. Hallelujah! But when the day comes, I don't want to have myself standing as an American. I want my being to take pride. Maybe it's the wrong word, but I don't know how else to decide it. Take my confidence in the fact of the calling and the election that is on my life.
Yes, amen.
The fact that God selected me, elected me. He birthed me out of nothing into something. He gave me something that was not mine to have, but because he loved me, he created a position for me, and he made it available unto me, and he gave me the opportunity to be something that I could never hope to obtain. Hallelujah. Paul goes on to say, I know that in me, verse 18, in my flesh. Do you know that? Do you have that revelation? I don't think so. That in you dwelleth no good thing. Huh? And that the thing that dwelleth there is no good. Huh? Hallelujah. Dwelleth no good, for the will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. My, do I thank God for the advocate that we have with the Father, that I can come to him in this position of transgression, in this position of desperation, and cry out to him to change me, irrevocably change me, so that I will not find myself in this position or in this place.
Amen.
And that is the solution to the problem, because Paul says, who shall deliver me from this body of death? Death, 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 death. Who shall deliver me from this entity that is Burt Asbill dead? And all of the Asbills that come after him, and all of the Ellsberries, and all of the thrill kills, and all of the murders, and all of the people that have spent time in jail, or down in the bar, or wherever they spent their lives expending themselves, huh? For the sake of humanity, because they were under the hold of Satan being encapsulated in sin and death. Hallelujah. And in the midst of that hellhole, God brought forth a revelation unto me that I could reach forth out of this pit, out of this hell, out of this hole, out of this tomb. Reach forth out of the midst of this ground of desolation and barrenness and touch him.
Hallelujah.
My God.
Hallelujah.
My God. My God, what a word we have.
Amen.
What an opportunity we have. What a revelation of understanding that God is giving us with regards to the fact of what we are and where we are and who we are, and the fact of the matter that we have to be something else entirely different. And he's put within us the capability, the potentiality. He's put within us the element of the seed to bring forth the living reality of the totality that is him. What more could I ask? What more could I want? What is there in this life that is so good or so desirous that would sidetrack me or make me subvert or divert my attention? Huh? Why would I, when reading these scriptures, want to exalt myself or be proven right even? When I have an advocate, I have a promise, I have a word. That is so totally, absolutely incomprehensible by my human, finite mind that it even takes God to bring forth a revelation that I might be able to grasp hold of the reality of who he is. I want Jesus. And he can have everything else. I want Jesus. He can have everything else. He can have it. Preeminence, predominance,
position of exaltation, position of admiration, whatever it he can have it. I do not want it. Don't want it. Don't want it. I don't want it for my children. I don't want it for my grandchildren. There is nothing that is in me is of any value. But there is something that I have that wasn't in me when I was born, but I got when I was born again. That is theirs for the taking if I have the desire to give it to them. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I find then a law that is present, that when I would do good, evil is present within me. Go back over there. If you, I'm not going to do it tonight. I didn't even get to the scripture. But it says that there were two nations that were warring within the womb of Rebekah. And those two nations are a viable evidence. They are of a testimony to the fact of what happens to you and I as believers. One was called Jacob, the other was called Esau. One is of God, the other is of sin. The nature of sin, warring against the nature of righteousness. Each one striving, I hope, for the position of predominance. But oftentimes, the younger that is supposed to be the one in the position of mastery is oftentimes found in the position of servitude. That's what Paul was talking about. Huh? But he says, Who shall deliver me? Who shall deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ. He said it another way in another place. He says, little children. Oh, little children. Oh, my. I can identify with the church of Galatia. Huh? Have you begun in the spirit? Just to finish in the flesh? I can identify. Oh, little children, I travail again. Why? That Christ, here we have that travailing ministry. The Holy Ghost working in your and my set of circumstances, travailing over us, that Christ might be formed in us in the midst of our present particular, peculiar situation, that there might be a demonstration and an exaltation of the Spirit of God over our actual flesh. Amen. That's the inheritance that I want to pass on to my progeny. That's the inheritance that I want to see manifested within the church. That's the church that I'm looking for. That's the church that my heart desires to be a part of. Not something man-made or concocted on the basis of some sort of religious perception, but a viable, breathing, livable entity that is called Christ. What is your hope? What is your expectation? What is the reason for which you are striving in the midst of your circumstances? If it is not for Christ's sake, then whose sake is it? We need to examine our situations. We need to examine our circumstance. We need to ascertain what our priorities are and how are those priorities a scriptural basis on which by which we might begin to give our attention and our care to. Hallelujah. Having these truths made evident, what manner of men ought we to be? And what should be our attitude in the midst of our present particular, peculiar set of circumstances? God bless you.
We would like to make available to you the following books. Nuggets for the Needy, a collection of spiritual encouragement for the hungry Christian by Mavis Duseal. The Pattern reveals to us the typology of the Tabernacle of Moses into biblical instructions for our time. The Book of Revelation, a 3-volume set of one of the most extensive and in-depth commentaries ever written. To order, write to Sunlight Gospel Association, Post Office Box 8237, Port St. Lucie, Florida 34985, or visit our website at slgospel.com.
And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my mouth and let me bear gladly the warm truth everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare love with thy cheek.